So we've just had a video go viral. It was about driving at low RPM, particularly with regard to lugging the engine, using the throttle, putting it under load at low RPM. And the question that just kept cropping up was, what is a low RPM? Now, there's a reason I didn't define low RPM in that specific video. And that's something that I'm just going to expound on and develop as a topic in this video. And the question really that we should be asking ourselves is our engine the correct size? Do we have the right vehicle? You might think of your car as like Goldilocks would approach life. Things can be just right, or they can be too big, too powerful, or too small and too underpowered. And in this video as well, we're going to see why it is essential to get the right engine for the job that you need it to do. So first off, what is the right RPM? What's a low RPM? What constitutes lugging the engine? Well, it's impossible to exactly define and quantify that because it varies from engine to engine. The key thing though, as a driver, is to be aware of when your engine is struggling. So you can tell you're lugging the engine because it's struggling. It's like riding a bike uphill in high gear. It takes a lot of effort from your legs to make very little progress. You're working against the mechanical advantage. So if you drop to a lower gear on your bike, you'd be pedaling faster, but less effort would be required. And it's the same in a car engine. If you're in the wrong gear, the engine is working overly hard. So just very briefly, and I'm not going to go into technical details and explanations of how engines work, but I just really want you to grasp the basic fundamentals. And what's going on in your engine will vary. If you've got a modern engine with drive-by-wire, it's going to be a lot more protective than an older engine that perhaps is carburetor fed or doesn't have a sophisticated ECU and drive-by-wire setup. At low RPM, the piston inside the engine is moving more slowly. The combustion event takes the same amount of time, but it's happening through a much shorter rotation of the crank. So effectively, you've got a large pressure wave hitting the piston. So that's potentially going to be detrimental to the lifespan of the components in the engine. This pressure wave is going to exert forces and shocks on all the other components inside the engine, from the piston to the rods and then onto the crank itself. So modern engines will mitigate the problem to some extent. So they'll back off the throttle. So you'll probably just notice that you're not making very swift progress. But the problems you're going to have by doing this repeatedly, putting the engine or trying to put the engine under heavy load, is just really you're making the engine work much harder than it should. If you've got a particulate filter, and most cars now are going to have particulate filters, they're going to struggle to burn cleanly and burn off the soot that has accumulated inside the particulate filter. And if you've got a modern high compression engine, particularly a turbocharged engine, there is a greater risk of low speed pre-ignition, and the overall risk on most engines of knock and detonation is increased because the combustion event is delayed to give the optimum angle of the piston and rod against the crank to try and extract as much power as we can. If you're trying to accelerate and the car engine is not responding, then chances are you're in the wrong gear. So obviously this whole video, like the last one, applies mainly to manual drivers or those with manual gear selection on their automatic box. So it does really matter which gear we are in. So in this video, we're just going to talk very briefly about the power band. The power band is defined as being the gap in the RPM range between peak torque and peak horsepower. That is different for every car, for different types of engine. So with diesel engines, for example, you'll notice they've got a very narrow power band. They have a lot of torque at that low end of the RPM range. They're really built and designed to provide lots of torque low down. So driving within that power band is certainly not a problem. The engine is going to perform its best. It's not going to struggle. But even those diesel engines may struggle if you're in a high gear like fifth gear and you're trying to accelerate from 20 miles an hour. Even with these really torquey diesel engines, we can still potentially lug them. Now, you take a gasoline or petrol engine like the VTEC, the very, very high revving, you'll notice that the power band, the usable power band, is much higher up in the RPM range. So ideally, you really want to be exploiting that when you're accelerating and you're needing the car to make progress. If you had a rotary engine, it is just like the VTEC, but much more extreme. The RPM red line is so much higher on those rotary engines, and it's very, very torque shy low down. So you have a very narrow power band right up the top end of the RPM range. So again, if you want to accelerate and make rapid progress, you need to be in that power band. If you have a turbocharged engine, you'll notice there's often a bit of lag where you don't get very much happening. But with most modern engines, you'll see the turbo cutting in at about 1,500 RPM, and it will deliver a decent amount of power right up to a higher point in the rev range. It really does help to look at a dyno printout of your car's power band and just get an idea for that power profile, because with that information, you can make a decision as to where you need to be in order to get the most power out of it, in order to accelerate without lugging the engine. So if we are lugging our engine, we're causing lots of problems for ourselves. So at the very least, we're going to suffer from carbon buildup. There's not much air flowing into and out of the engine. The modern exhaust gas recirculation systems and the diesel particulate filter as well is not going to thank you for that. So if you only do very short journeys, and it tends to be urban driving at relatively low speeds, a big engine can actually be a detriment to you, because you'll never get into the stride of that big engine's capacity. You'll only ever be chugging around at relatively low RPM. You've got lots of torque on hand, but that can run up some bills further down the line if we're not careful. However, if we do mainly highway or motorway miles, so we had a discussion recently on one of our videos where different countries use different terms for these. So we're talking about the fast roads that connect the towns and cities together. So if you're on those, you tend to be able to drive at faster speeds. In Germany, you've got the unrestricted autobahns. Here in the UK, we're restricted to about 70 miles an hour. In some other countries, the limits are up to 80 miles an hour or down to 50 miles an hour. But in these situations, you really want a more powerful engine that will not be straining itself too much to maintain the car's momentum. So if you had a very small capacity engine, a 3-cylinder, 1-litre engine, it's going to be working at the upper end of its RPM range to maintain the car's pace in that situation. So again, you wouldn't choose a small capacity engine if you wanted to do high speed cruising. If your situation is that you do a lot of stop start driving, you would certainly want to avoid something with a particulate filter, because these do tend to clog up a lot when you do lots of cold short journeys or lots of stop start journeys. They need a bit of a run in order to allow the particulate filter to burn off the particulates that it's collected over time. So why do people drive at low RPM? Well, they assume that it's the most economical, and in reality, it's not always the most economical. The correct gear for the situation is the most economical. So don't get carried away with this philosophy of hypermilers, that you keep the RPM as low as possible, because that's just not going to give you the best fuel economy. My car's got a bit of an anomaly, because I find I get better fuel economy at 1,600 RPM than I do at 1,200 RPM. And it's just interesting to know where your car's power band is, where the peak efficiency is, which is often somewhere just below the power band. And if you exploit that, you can get the maximum fuel economy from your engine. But again, use your gears as they were intended. You've not just got a Versi gear to use all the time that's sort of okay at 30 miles an hour and sort of okay at 60 or 70 miles an hour. You want to be in the right gear for the situation. And those high gears, the fifth gear or the sixth gear, if your car's got one, are really just for maintaining your speed on the highway. And a lot of recommendations on speed awareness courses that people have been on is to drop down to third gear at 30 miles an hour around town. It feels like you're screaming away at first, but you do get used to it. You're not actually screaming away. The RPM is still relatively low. It allows you to be more aware of the car's speed, to maintain that speed, which is why they recommend that on the speed awareness course. But the question raised was, does this mean you get less fuel economy? And in most cars, you don't for most of the time, because you're on very, very light throttle. You're in the upper part of the RPM range, you're using the car's power band, but with the light throttle, and it's the throttle that controls how much fuel the car is using, you're not using any more fuel than you would dropping it into fifth or sixth and burbling along at ridiculously low RPM figures. So it is something you will notice. The degree with which the damage is caused depends very much on your car, how frequently you do this. The worst case scenario, though, is that you're just chipping small fragments of metal off the engine components and increasing the stresses on the metals. So it's not going to blow the engine up instantly. You're talking about long-term accumulated wear and tear over the engine. And again, depending on how solid the engine is in the construction, you may get 100,000 miles out of it. You may only get 50 or 60,000 out of it. And you may even still get 200,000-300,000 miles out of it. But the upshot is, if you avoid putting the engine through all of this stress, it will overall last longer and you'll have less of a maintenance job or lower maintenance bills to keep the car running efficiently. I hope you found this video useful. Please boop that like button. If you have any questions, please drop them in the comments below and I'll create a video answering those questions to the best of my ability. Thanks for all your support. If you haven't subscribed to the channel, please do so, because we'd hate you to miss out on the great content we've got planned that allow you to get the best out of your car and maintain your car in good condition and avoid those high running costs. And I've lined this video up for you that should help you to do just those things. Thanks for watching. See you in this next video.